Thank you to the organizer for inviting me to discuss with you about this topic, which has been the research topic of my, one of my research topics over the last 10 years. Okay, this is before starting, this is the declaration of a conflict of interest. Of course, the research you are going to show has been partly financed by many institutions, like also the Kamut enterprises, which has participated in the financing of some studies, but not actively participated in the analysis, in the data analysis. Okay, I start from the beginning, showing you some epidemiological data relating to the medical consideration in general. This is the main causes. These are the main causes of death of at all ages in the Western countries. As you can see, the main causes are always the same 10 leading causes, which including chronic degenerative diseases. So cardiovascular disease are the first places, but also metabolic diseases and neoplastic disease. Overall, the world is the same thing. Also in the developing countries, in countries after 2011, the situation changed, and now the situation is similar also to in non-industrialized countries. If we go to the risk factor associated with the chronic degenerative disease, the risk factors are always the same, and the diet is at the first place. So diet plays a key role in the determining the occurrence of chronic degenerative disease. But these things, this issue, we know from many years, because this is just one of the review showing you that we have a strong evidence reporting an association between consumption of some food groups, like fruit and vegetables and cereals, in terms of reducing risk of cardiovascular and neoplastic disease, while we have a strong evidence showing that if we consume more detrimental foods like meats, for example, you have a reduction, an increased risk of occurrence of chronic degenerative disease. What about grains? The role of grains in human nutrition is really important, because if you see that in physiology of nutrition, grains represent the primary source of energy, and if you take into account 100% of our diet, so a general diet, about 55 to 60% needs to be to come from grains. And if you just do an example of 2,000 kilocalories per day of a normal diet of a general population, about more than 1,000 kilocalories should come from grains or from carbohydrates. And grains in general comes from this is the per capita consumption of cereals in the European Union. You can see that most of the grains comes from wheat, and if you see the table just here, you can see that more than 90% of the calories coming from carbohydrates come from wheat. And if you translate these things into Italy, is extremely 99%. So we are consumers of wheat in general in the Mediterranean basin. Is the most important cereal is wheat, with a small proportion of rice, like just here. This is extremely known, because if you see that the Mediterranean diet, which you probably know is a healthy diet, my Mediterranean diet needs or include three most important leaves in their dietary profile, which are the grape, so wine, olive oil, and wheat. So this is the principles of my Mediterranean diet. Probably the beneficial effect of Mediterranean diet just rely on these three main aspects of the diet. And the Mediterranean diet, as you probably know, I'm going to show you one of our updated meta-analysis in 17 cohort study, more than 2 million subjects all over the world, showing that if you consume in a Mediterranean-like dietary pattern, you have a reduction of 9% of overall mortality, 10% of cardiovascular disease, 5% of cancer, at 13% of neurodegenerative disease. So we have stable and convincing evidence that this is, as other dietary profile, is beneficial for our health. What happened in the last 50 years? In the last 50 years, it happened that if you see the graph showing the adherence to Mediterranean diet in the 1960, just here on the left, and you see the comparison with the adherence to Mediterranean diet in 2000, the situation dramatically changed. in terms of a reduction of adherence into Mediterranean diet. So the population that were typical of the Mediterranean basin, and you can see better in this slide, so the typical Mediterranean countries, which are the one on the below under the just on red highlights, all the Mediterranean countries reduce the adherence to Mediterranean diet, while the other countries and the non-Mediterranean countries increase the Mediterranean diet. And what changes? If you see the changes happen in the last 40 years in dietary habits, you can see that in 1960 the diet of the general population was about of 2,000 kilocalories, representing with 50% of grains and 16% of sugar and 6% of meat, while in 2011 the situation changed in terms of an increase of kilocalories, about 700 kilocalories per mean of general population. But what changed is a reduction of grain, 5% of grain, and an increase of sugar, fat and meat. So this is the things that they are dramatically changed in 50 years, and this probably we can say that is concomitantly what happened in on the other hand happened that we saw an explosion of this the we call the hidden epidemic of the non-celiac gluten sensitivity. So the person who start to be not allergic, not intolerant, but sensitive to something which is gluten. But if you think that we have concomitantly reduced the consumption of grains, so something doesn't come in the same way, because we should have reduced the occurrence of these things. But on the other hand, we saw an explosion of these patients, and we saw an explosion as well also of the prevalence of the so-called irritable bowel syndrome, which is a syndrome just not really well defined, but we have a lot of subjects coming to our ambulatories showing gastrointestinal symptoms, very well, not well known, well, not well defined, but person with malabsorption, with intestinal distress, uncomfort. So the things that we didn't show in the past, and we know now in the present, and there is a really an increasing prevalence. This is just an estimated prevalence in the westernized countries of about 20% of the population suffering from these symptoms. So on one hand, we saw a reduction of grains consumption overall the world with a modulation in terms of reduction of width overall the world, an increase of other cereals, and on the other hand, we saw an increase of prevalence of some pathologies like non-celiac gluten sensitivity, which was completely unknown about 10 years ago, and an increase and explosion of this syndrome. So the question is, what happened? We don't know what happened, but we can postulate some hypotheses. One of the hypotheses, and that's why we are here, that something happened with the evolution of grains. This is the typical graph showing the evolution of grains in the last, of course you know better than me these things, but we had an evolution of grains in terms of different centuries, from centuries ago, from wild species to cultivated species. So we are not eating the same thing we ate in the past. And this probably has determined and affected something, because if we see in general the modern width, we have a high production, so we have species that are highly productive, we have a lot of protein, so increased protein intake, increased gluten intake, but we had also a reduced biodiversity and reduced nutritional properties of this width. Because that's why, probably because the industrial process just rely or paid attention more on commercial and technological quality with respect to nutritional quality. We started to work in this field 10 years ago, and 10 years ago no one talked about the nutrition quality of what we were eating, while now probably we face more on this aspect. So something probably happened, and the typical figure we show, and this figure comes from Professor Bernadettelli, University of Florence. We saw a reduction of size of wheat, a reduction and increase capacity of to produce, but also we had an increase of protein from 11.5 to more than 14.5, an increase of gluten, an increase of strength of the flour. So this probably can be one of the postulated mechanisms or hypotheses that can explain some of the things we are facing now and we didn't know before about 20 years ago. That's why the interest comes on ancient grains. Ancient grains, I'm not showing what is ancient grain, but just showing some of the species we have here in Italy, but we have also in other countries, some of them. Why we need to take attention, to pay attention on ancient grains. From nutritional point of view, we have differences in terms of the species compounds of polyphenols and antioxidant properties in terms of more in terms of variety than in terms of quantity. In terms of quantity, there is a little difference, but not so striking. While we have a difference in terms of compounds, as you can see here, in the modern variety have 22 compounds, while in ancient varieties have more than 33 compounds. So there is a highly variability of this of these compounds, and the same thing has been shown also by Professor Dinelli here in a paper published in 2011. While the phytochemical profile and nutraceutical value of ancient variety like Berna here, this one, is completely different from Palaeo, which was the modern. So there is a difference. Probably it's not this difference that is the responsible for the health effect, but there is a difference. And there is a difference also in terms of level of the FODMAPs, which are the fruit oligo monodisaccharides, which are the small part of the carbohydrates which goes into our intestine and determine bloating. So this is which is one of the symptoms, the most important symptom of the irritable bowel syndrome. And if you can see, you can see the difference, the striking difference from one modern to one ancient. So there is something. There are some mechanisms that are hypothesized. So with this in mind, with this background, in 2010 we started to do some clinical trials on this aspect with ancient grains as a key player. And we did different studies. The first study was made in clinically healthy subjects. For us, clinically healthy subjects means person with general population without any type of disease, without any type of risk factor, so general population, healthy population. In 2010, the first study was published in Journal of Medicinal Food, and the ancient grain this way was Berna variety here in Italy. And the design of the study is the similar with all the studies I'm going to show you later, so the similar design like a pharmacological studies with the two arms, one arm, one group, starting with the ancient in this example, bread, so ancient bread for 8 weeks, with respect to the modern bread for 8 weeks, made with the same process, with the same industries, so with the same process. After 8 weeks, there was a washout period, so the person started again to eat normally as they did before the study, and then there was a crossover, so the person who started with the modern wheat begin to eat in the ancient wheat and so on. We had three withdrawal, blood withdrawal and clinical evaluation at T0, so at baseline, at the beginning, at the crossover, at the crossing over phase and at the end. This is the typical example of a design study of a pharmacological with the drug A and drug B. We need our placebo and then drug at the same thing. And what we found was a reduction, a significant reduction of total cholesterol, even if the person were clinically healthy, so the values were slightly normal, but there was a reduction while we didn't see a reduction in the modern variety, and we saw a reduction, a significant reduction for LDL cholesterol, which is the bad cholesterol for letting you know, while the same values for a modern variety, so no significant reduction for a modern variety. And the other thing is most important for us, for cardiovascular disease, this is the whole blood viscosity, so how the blood flow in the arteries and veins, look at the viscosity, just reduce, significantly reduce in the Verna variety, so the ancient variety with respect to the modern variety. After this, in the clinical LT subject, we replicated the study also in another group of clinical LT subjects with a more complex design, because this was a project financed by the region of Tuscany region where I work, and the design was more complex because there were two intervention phases, one with the Verna variety, which was the similar to the previous one, and the other one with the two other varieties, and one phase at the middle of a modern variety, so it was a more complex design with 46 subjects, but the results were similar. So look at the glycemia, blood glucose, there was a reduction in both group, in both interventions with the ancient variety, while a general normal values or more not significant difference for in the modern variety, as well as for total cholesterol. Look here, there's a reduction here and reduction here, while a stabilization here or an increase there, and LDL cholesterol. So the same results we show in Verna variety. So in light of these results, we thought, yes, but these results come from just a substitution of bread, which is just one food of our diet. So we need to do something in another group of population with a replication and substitution of all the cereal you consume in our diet. So we designed a study in subjects at a high risk for cardiovascular disease, means that they did not have cardiovascular disease, but they have a high risk profile, for example, high blood cholesterol or high blood glucose and so on. And we did these things with Kamut brand products in cardiovascular risk factors, 22 clinical healthy subjects, 8 males and 14 females, while we have a replacement diet. What does it mean? We replaced everything: bread, pasta, biscuits, crackers, flour, every grain products. So the person for 8 weeks just need to eat in this way with the product we gave to them, in terms of test products and control products made by the same industry with the same process, with the same semi-integral flours, but with coming from different flours. And we saw at the beginning that if you look at the mineral profile of semolina and flour were completely different in terms of chemistry or control. And if we analyze the blood measurements in these patients after these 8 weeks, we saw a reduction of total cholesterol, a reduction of LDL cholesterol, an increase of mineral profile in the blood of patients who consume these products. But more importantly, we saw a reduction of inflammatory cytokines like TNF-alpha, which is extremely important in terms of occurrence of cardiovascular and neoplastic disease. Seeing this, we replicated, so we said, okay, probably there is something, there should be something in terms of a mechanism, but we need to do the same thing in the patients suffering from what I told you before was an epidemic of these things, so irritable bowel syndrome. So we did the same study design, but with different study control, study population in terms of irritable bowel syndrome. In this kind, it was a double blind, so the person didn't know what they were eating in terms of the same bread made by two different flours. In this population, we investigated the symptoms, the gastrointestinal symptoms, the quality of life, which is extremely important for them, and the biochemical parameters, but more importantly, the gastrointestinal symptoms using two different questionnaires, which is the EBS Global Improvement Scale. So it means that just the person needs to answer to a question like, compared to the way you felt before, have your symptoms over the past been substantially worse or worsened or improved and so on. And the same thing in the so-called severity scale. So you need to point a mark in terms of from 0 to 100 to showing the gravity of the severity of your symptom. If you see the results after 1 week, just 1 week, the two curves just diverge in terms of increasing, so reducing the severity of symptoms in the intervention study with the Kamut products and the stabilization in terms of the organic control products. And the same thing was for bloating, which is one of the most important symptoms in these patients. And more importantly, I'm going to highlight these things, the quality of life increased. Because these are patients that they have nothing of organic things. So they have no tumor or no plastic or cardiovascular disease, but they have a reduction of quality of life in terms of satisfaction with the stool consistency, or in terms of distress, in terms of anxiety, or in terms of quality of life in general, or tiredness, of course. The other things as we made with the cardiovascular disease. So patients with established cardiovascular disease, we did the same thing in 22 patients with the coronary acute coronary syndromes, means that are subjects that were diagnosed with a myocardial infarction or a stable angina, taking a lot of prescriptions, of course, but also in them, if we replace the diet with all the control or the test product, we had the same results in terms of reduction, which is slight, of course, small, but significant, 9%, 8% of glucose. Look at this difference of insulin, which is the hormone regulating the glucose. And the other thing was a significant difference in terms of oxidative stress. So the reactive oxygen species produced by the lymphocytes and the monocytes. The other things I'm going not to show you the results because they are similar is for type 2 diabetes. This is the study. But evaluating all the studies we did in the last 10 years, we just put all the results. We made about 8 studies for a total of 224 subjects, including also this study you are going to show later by Dr. Dino in one of the oral presentation, which is the last one in NAFLD, non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. But if you include all the things and you put everything in common and together, we can see that we have a reduction, significant reduction, which is slight for us, but significant. This is extremely important, of 10% about a mean reduction of total cholesterol, 7.8% of LDL cholesterol, and the reduction of insulin and blood glucose. But most importantly, a reduction which is significantly in all the studies for the inflammatory parameters. So that's something that should be in terms of biochemical and clinical implication. If you are interested, this is the review we published 5 months ago in Journal of Nutritional Biochemistry, showing that these results, but also results from other groups, not just by us, of course, showing the biochemical and clinical implication. So the question is why this ancient grains could be beneficial for our health. The hypotheses are different. We try to figure some mechanism. So probably the increase of the amylose reduce the glucose and insulin, the increase of monounsaturated fat in these grains reduce total cholesterol and LDL cholesterol, the higher content of minerals in the flour of these grains increase the mineral profile in the blood, and also the biodiversity, the higher content of polyphenols and the higher biodiversity of the polyphenols can affect the inflammatory cytokines and also the antioxidant pyramids. Of course, there are hypotheses. We have other also person who say that probably these are not the mechanism. I don't think these are just the mechanism. This is one of the review of Professor Shevoli showing that probably this is not really the mechanism, because in their study he didn't know the striking difference in this. I think that we need to do more studies understanding if these are the mechanism in terms of improvement of these parameters. And so we could say the older is better. I give you some point of discussion. I know that this is the keynote lecture, but I think that if we wanted to do a discussion, I think if they agree, we can deal without. I agree with, so not a problem. But I give you some points of discussion, maybe later or in the morning. Are always better the ancient grains? Are they sustainable for our health and sustainable for the world? Which role for the middle of production? In my opinion, of course, what I know, always better, no. They are not always better. We need to work on the type of grain. Are sustainable, yes, from the environmental side, but not for the general population. We cannot think that to produce ancient grains for all the world population, of course. And the middle of our production, there is a need. An urgent need to determine regulation. We have examples, not just because we are here, but we have example of Kamut, we have example also of other things. We need to work on putting laws, regulation, because now it's a fashion, the ancient grains. When it's a fashion, the fashion means that the person comes to produce, everyone produce ancient grains with their own laws. This is not good for us. So not older, but better. Thank you very much.